Thank you for the invitation. The total number of Dutch Mennonite ministers who were National Socialists is not yet known. There were no war criminals among them, as can be concluded from 5 portraits of National Socialist ministers written by Gabo Hoekema. Although demonstrating little inclination toward discrimination and murder, they did not distance themselves from such actions in public. In this lecture, I will discuss 2 Mennonite ministers who were opponents with respect to the relationship between Anabaptist theology and political position. Cornelis Bonnehielkema is described as a fascist party ideologist of the NSB, the Dutch National Socialist Movement. During the occupation, this movement collaborated with the Germans. Fritz Kuiper was a chairman of the Dutch Mennonite Arbeidsgroep tegen de Krijgsdienst, a working group assisting conscientious objectors, and he was a member of the organization Church and Peace and of the political party SDAP, the Social Democratic Labour Party. These intellectual ministers were opposites at ministerial meetings and other gatherings where they expounded their differing views of Christianity and Anabaptism. What position did they, as Mennonites, who are known for their theology of community, take on the state, parliamentary democracy, and the monopoly on violence in a period in which Hitler was preparing his politics of annexation? Were their arguments motivated by Anabaptism? Where did they set the boundary between the faith community and the world? The period concerned here is the first stage of the NSB beginning in 1933. Italian fascism, which did not have an anti-Semitic bias, still formed a strong source of inspiration. We should position both ministers in a Dutch Mennonite context in which nonviolence is no longer being taught unequivocally, and the general religious climate is liberal. That is to say, the Dutch Mennonite Conference did not have a generally adopted church order by which sanctions could be imposed on members who were not in harmony with the principle of non-resistance, for instance. The adage of the ADS, the General Mennonite Conference, was that it should be possible for all political convictions to exist side by side in a congregation. Such neutrality and freedom was an important characteristic of the Dutch Mennonite liberalism. In practice, this meant that people with National Socialist sympathies could perform their ministry or their service in a governing body as usual. Yet, news magazines and ministerial associations spoke of their uneasiness about the issues in Germany. There, the ADS governing body was urged to take a position on the dangers of National Socialism. Clearly, there was a division among Dutch Mennonites on the political position of the ADS. The secretary, the Reverend Sepp, a National Socialist, was not trusted and he resigned. I will be giving Hielkema and Kuiper the platform by means of 4 aspects: the relationship between church and state, Anabaptists and their arguments, non-resistance and the faith community. But I will begin by asking who they were. Cornelis Bonnehielkema, PhD, a retired minister of Haarlem, regarded himself as a historian and idealist. He studied theology at the Mennonite Seminary and served 3 congregations. And of the 3 sons and 1 daughter he and his wife Goverta de Klerk had, all but the 2nd son joined the NSB in 1933. Hielkema was originally a supporter of democracy, but later he adhered to the principle of leadership, being of the opinion that the political parliamentary system in the Netherlands should be replaced by a strong leader. In 1932, he wrote up a rational, empirical religious ideology in a book entitled Werkelijkheidstheologie, The Theology of Reality. In this book, he teaches that we can know God only through reality. And humans have a religious instinct by nature. This instinct evolves in such a way that humans ultimately attain fulfillment and truth in self-sacrifice. Self-sacrifice is the most noble characteristic of the new human being, the Homo fascistus. His werkelijkheidstheologie may be viewed as providing the theological foundation for his other book, Het Nederlands Fascisme, Dutch Fascism, published in 1934. In this book, he tries to give a Dutch twist to an ethical and religious fascism that can be traced to the humanist tradition of the Brethren of the Common Life, a 14th century group, and Erasmus of Rotterdam, 16th century. Het Nederlands Fascisme was a bestseller until 1937, when it was forbidden. After an electoral defeat in 1937, and through pressure from within, the general leader, Mussert, adopted German Nazism, including its racist anti-Semitism. Hülkemark never claimed to have been a propagandist, even though he was listed as being one. After the liberation, he and his wife were arrested, interrogated, and imprisoned for 15 months. Hülkemark died in 1948. Reverend Fritz Kuyper was a minister in Alkmaar during the war. His family included intellectual Mennonite ministers on both sides. As a theology student, he attended the lectures of the theologian Karl Barth. He helped alleviate the famine among fellow students in the Russian Kazan, and there he also learned to appreciate Bolshevist values, although he later severely criticized its approach to human rights. Back in the Netherlands, he joined the SDAP in 1925. He regarded the party as giving form to the political aspect of the biblical call to justice. Although opponents lumped the SDAP together with the Bolshevists, the party strongly rejected dictatorship and terror. This explains why the pacifistic Kuyper could join this political party. During the occupation in 1941, he published the book Gemeente in de Wereld, The Faith Community in the World, to encourage people in the event the church were to be forbidden. Kuyper was involved in the resistance. He hid Jews and worked on the newspaper of the underground resistance, Free Netherlands. And because of the help he gave to Jews, but also because of his bond with the State of Israel in 1948, he was honored with a park in the Ben Shemen Forest in Modi'in in Israel after his death in 1974. Now, what positions did Hülkemark and Kuyper take on the state? Hülkemark accented Jesus' devotion to the love of God, and this was to be an example for the National Socialist. National Socialists were expected to be prepared to submit themselves to the creation order which the Almighty God had provided and of which the nation was a part. The National Socialist asks, what can I give instead of what do I get? The church could function freely in this creation order as long as it formed no danger for the fascist state. Many people in the NSB were perturbed about this. According to Hülkemark, it was therefore necessary to pay close attention to what ministers were preaching. De Weerafdeling, the parliament military organization of the NSB, would take harsh action against spiritual leaders who raised themselves above others and took it upon themselves to pass moral judgment on the fascist ideal state. Hülkemark opposed the testimony of church and peace that the gospel and war are irreconcilable opposites, and he rejected the total disarmament argued by the organization. The church should stay with its calling to proclaim eternity, and it should form politicians into humble personalities. Naturally, God, who is above all governments, should be obeyed above others when the impossible is demanded in a dictatorship. But that pertained to an extreme case, for fascism did not propagate an absolute state. Kuiper's objection to the National Socialism is based on a strict separation of church and state. The faith community is part of the state, but it needs to keep the interference of other ideologies at bay. By being conscious of Christ, the church maintains its independence and its ability to proclaim God's message to all the powers of the world. This means that the task of the church is to remind the individual and society of God and his commandments. It involves pointing out to society that it should not slide into idolatry, such as the kind taking place in Germany, where the Aryan race, the nation, and the doctrine of leadership were being glorified. In short, the faith community is in the world and at the same time in confrontation with it. Dialectically, Kuiper transfers this to the position of Christ against Pilate. The faith community and the world are always in conflict because they both want to have control over human beings. But the ultimate victory of Christ means that the church should turn away from militarism and national socialism. How did Hylkema and Kuiper utilize Anabaptism as their arguments? Hylkema does not mention Anabaptism explicitly as a source of inspiration for his ideas in either of his books, but he is recognizably theologically Anabaptist when he poses that faith and works are one. For him, faith is belief in self-sacrifice. This clearly reveals the fascist inner motivation of love and perseverance for the ideal state and for the authority of the general leader. But Kuiper is in favor of social democracy. This system allows Christians to choose freely which party best fulfills biblical justice. For him, socialism was the experience of justice, expression of justice. And for this reason, he was convinced that Dutch Mennonites should have acknowledged Karl Marx and the socialist movement. Mennonites, as Christian socialists, should always take a stand against injustice to fellow citizens and the working class, and against a ban on worship and a Christian upbringing. Kuiper connects the unity of faith and works with resistance to injustice. And this could go hand in hand with bringing sacrifices, including one's own life. The faith community must be prepared to suffer, for that was the way it preserved its independence. In other sources, Mennonite NSBers draw a parallel between the Anabaptist congregational model and the national community of the NSB. Mennonites came for the furtherance of community and not primarily for the minister. In the same way, the individual in National Socialism exists for the national community. And where the importance of the community above that of the individual is concerned, there is no difference between the NSB and the Anabaptist faith community. What role did non-resistance play in their considerations? Hylkema agrees that violence and war are not in the spirit of Christ, but he himself was not a pacifist. He would not reject an anti-militarist, but he does not approve of conscientious objectors. This is poorly understood Christianity. A Christian people is armed and able-bodied. The fascist has to fight in the name of God. In this light, it is remarkable that during the interrogations after the war, he wrote German violence off as psychotic unpleasantness. He illustrates this his view by pointing to Anabaptist ancestors who were against bearing arms, the Inquisition, and the death penalty. But the NSB displayed the opposite. Actually, Hilkema was stuck between his fascist ideology, which had failed, and the reality of an Anabaptist nonviolent history. Kuiper connects non-resistance to a total concentration on Christ's victory. In this light, every nation is transient, and there is no reason to worship the nation or authorities. It is the Christian's calling to witness to God and his kingdom. Christians have the freedom to say no to military service. But he experienced a turning point when the Germans execute two of his nephews by firing squad. Shortly after the liberation, he lets his good friend Cornelius Kran know that he no longer has the courage to continue with peace work. He realized that he did not truly hold to non-resistance any longer. But later, he was to attend Mennonite peace conferences again. What was their vision of the faith community of which they were members? According to Hilkema, the church derives its meaning from the proclamation of grace. Grace restores our self-confidence and our trust in God. This makes the church a place of refuge for the spirit in a turbulent reality. This applies to people inside and outside the faith community. All find forgiveness and justification there. Hilkema proceeds from a common grace granted to all people with no regard for their religion. This idea is in keeping with the classical Dutch Anabaptism, which teaches a common grace. But it is also in keeping with the universalism of humanism of the fascist ideal. He puts this into practice by appearing at the Sunday service the day after his release, but a colleague requested him not to show up again. He felt pierced to the heart as he wrote to the church council. He withdrew into solitude. The question is whether he was able to enter into the feelings of the faith community enough, but there is also this question: how abundant is common grace anyway? During the war, there were members of the NSB in Kuiper's congregation, but this did not lead to betrayal. He continued to preach open-heartedly, and he held firmly to the principle of the faith community as a service of reconciliation. As in many other congregations, the burning question after the war was how to deal with the brothers and sisters who were released from detention camps. In Kuiper's congregation, members considered it a Christian duty to take those who had been condemned into the congregation immediately. Sometimes it took years before reconciliation occurred, but it did. Summarized, what theological positions did Hilkema and Kuiper take as supporter and opponent of National Socialism? In systematical terms, Hilkema maintained the idea of a creation order, and he applied to the principle of leadership to this. Decisions were made from above to below, which required responsibility from below to above, a watertight hierarchy. Kuiper thought and acted with the kingdom of Christ as starting point against the powers of the world, whereby Christ was presumed the victor even though his struggle was not yet over. What makes their positions even more complicated is the hermeneutics. Here and there, they applied the same biblical texts to their personal faith of personal vision of faith. A text such as "Do not rule but serve" was used by Hilkema as a support for subjection to fascism, while Kuiper saw it as a support for the faith community in the world. The result of the positions taken by these two was that Dutch Mennonites kept quiet about Hylkema already shortly after the war, while Kuiper was honored for a long time afterwards.